Is a continuation of Fog Lounge's Windsor Rockwall project that started about 2 years ago now. Tom Lusher, the co-owner of Fog Lounge, started it. Basically what it was a bunch of craft paper taped up to the walls of the inside of Fog, where people could write down band names and then also members of bands and connect the members to other bands. And it grew out of control, I'd say, to the point where more papers needed to be added around the perimeter of it to make it bigger, and the connections got to the point where they were pretty much not readable on the paper anymore. I mean, you could spend a lot of time looking at it, and it's definitely really interesting to look at, but I guess the idea was to kind of, with the WindsorMusicTangle.com, is to turn that physical paper into a website database.
So this is my office, the Central Library, the Windsor Public Library Central Branch. I use this computer for entering data. It's the library's computer. Over here on the whiteboard, these are just like extra notes or just weird oddities that came about in my entering of data. For example, you know, people have different last names, especially the women. If they've been married, their name changes, so I just have to make sure it's the same person. And I've kind of evolved those into a more detailed list that I've kind of been asking people, such as, who is Doug on guitar in the Neffadovs? What is his last name? Who is Tommy B from The Best? Broken Fellow, is it Jake or Chris? Just like the most random odd notes that anyone reading this, probably it wouldn't make sense to them, but for me it keeps me on track of what I need to do. Right here, this is kind of like what I'm working with in terms of all the promotional materials that is littering my office right now. This is what we're going to be doing for all the printing. We have this device, which is a one color, one station silkscreen press. Super fun. It's going to be installed in the basement where I'll be working on that kind of stuff. There's the fun stuff, but there's also the administrative stuff going on here. These are just some old notes. Something like this is what I would work off of for a while. I would just pull information off of social media websites that people are giving me, making sure it's entered in. The original Rockwall at Fog Lounge. These are notes from people at Fog or given to Tom. So just various notes from Tom, all of which have already been entered into the database. This is what we're working with Spotvin to develop the website, and this is what we're kind of basing it off of. It's a JavaScript-based musician map that visualizes music collaborations over time, and we're kind of just altering this pre-existing model to suit our needs for the specific website. This is kind of just a reference sheet for me. It's really awesome when people give me stuff and it's all very nicely laid out like this. And it's not always the case, because a lot of the times people don't remember stuff, especially if it's like past the 90s. So a lot of the information will be missing, but this is a good example of a really complete document from someone. This is kind of like the layout of the website, how information connects. So you can go from band to musician to instrument, band to genre, band to decade, and then also the opposite way. So this is kind of how I mapped out the way that users can filter through the info?
I think in general the project was from a poster that I saw at ArtSite. They had brought posters in for a show that had to do with hornets and I forget what now. And the poster looked terrible on one side. And Bernie brought over a big stack and I said, he's like, do you want these posters? I was like, no, I don't want these. And I flipped them over and on the back was this like really beautiful silver on black. Like it had to be some kind of a screen. It was gorgeous, but it was just like a brainstorm of terms. And so I went, I want to do one of these. The discussion about trying to grow the music community or the arts community has always been something that in the last 5 years has been on my mind, where you see people leave every 3 years or, you know, every time they graduate, these big floods of people leave and you lose this talent. And so I also started wondering, you know, this crowd kind of stays the same. From a business perspective, I keep seeing the same people. I wish more people liked what we do and what these bands do. And I said, I think it's because these bands just keep shuffling the deck. It's the same deck, it's just getting shuffled. And you're not getting new family members, girlfriends, boyfriends interested in what's going on that stage. And it seemed very incestuous and insular. So I went, I would love to prove that in some kind of a graphic. And that idea hit me. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna do this. And I'm gonna show that there's very few new members per band that exist. So it came from like, I want to show that this might be a thing we could keep in mind when we're trying to put new acts together or trying to invite new people into the scene. So then it just started. And I clearly remember the paper. I finally splurged and bought the paper from Staples, just the big chart paper. And it came in the door and there were two people here. And Mike Edwards, being one of them, the lead singer of Lowdown, and an artist, like a visual artist for a long, long time. He just said, can I draw on that? And I'm like, no, you can't. I'm just, mind your own business. This is my paper. And he's like, let me draw something. I want to draw. I'm like, Mike, this is for a project that I'm, just leave me alone. The wall, I'm waiting for the walls to be bare, and then I'm going to do sections of this thing on the wall. Well, what are you going to do? So then I explain it to him. I said, but I don't know how. I know it's gotta be bands and people. I don't want it to repeat. I don't know how to do it, but it's gonna be connecting through lines. And he went, give me paper. And he started kind of drawing on it. And he's like, what markers do you have? Like, what colors? And what I had was a red Sharpie and a black Sharpie. So he just started it on a piece of paper. And I went, that will work. But you know, I kind of toiled for a minute about what would connect what, like what color lines. And then he went, just do it like this. Just do it simple. Just keep it black lines to connect everything. Keep the bands in red and the people yellow. And I'm like, maybe a bit more differentiation. He was like, rectangles around bands, circles around people or whatever. So he browbeat me to get the paper to put one on the wall so he could start it. And that is basically what happened. He went on there and me, I pictured the writing to be, you know, a quarter of an inch tall because there's a lot of information. I thought it would fit on four sheets. And he goes up and the first band he puts, his band is gigantic, like Lowdown is huge. I'm like, Mike, that's way too big. I'll just change it later. But in a matter of 2 or 3 hours, people kept coming in and adding to it. And by the end of that night even, there was probably 100 pieces of information on it, and then it just kept going. And no one was really complaining because people, right at that time, bands stopped making posters for shows. Like they just don't make, even now, they just rely on Facebook and they don't make posters like they used to make them. So it wasn't taking up space in that lobby like it was before. It wasn't hurting us by having it there instead of show posters, right? So that was it, just kept going from there. And then I started really hunting people down and asking them for info. I put it up at SB, at Contemporary Gallery, and then it went to the Art Gallery in September, right? So it was up for a long time. And the thing is it brightened up that room. As much as it is interesting, physically it brightened up that foyer, and I loved having it there, but it got too big. Like, it just wouldn't fit, and people were putting their feet on it because they were just leaning against that poster. It was being vandalized. Like, people were writing stuff all over it. So it was like, this thing's got to come down. The Windsor Star and Windsorite had done stories about the fact that the thing was made, period. So that's how I think Jean Foster at the library had heard about it. But then Mary Lou Gellison, who, you know, was a customer and knew about this thing, she was there. I'm sure that there was chit chat. There's a lot of people tied to the music community that are there. And so she just called me, I think, or emailed me and said, you know, I just want to talk to you about this rock wall thing, because it's a collection of information that it's an archive. We like information. We'd like to help you do something with it. And what would you like to do with it? And now Jean was writing grants for just about everything, right? So she just wanted to hear. She didn't say, oh, wouldn't you like to make this wallpaper? Or hey, like some grant she had in mind. Like, she said, what do you want to do with this? I could have said, I want to make wallpaper. I could have said anything. And I said, I want to make it digitized. I'd like it to be online. And she said, okay, well, I'm asking because I'd like to look in this database of grants, and I think there could be something for that. And then she got back to me, I don't know how many months later or a month later, and just said, we need to talk about what that would actually look like. How do you envision that? And it was pretty basic. Like I said, I would like the general aesthetic to stay the same, and then to just be on, to be online so that people could kind of interact with it instead of having to come to the physical space where this giant poster is. That's really hard to kind of follow. And she said, okay, we exchanged information about it, kind of just like an information session. And Jean had been like a bit of an acquaintance of mine through other projects. She helped me research ebooks for a friend of mine who's an author who was interested in it, a Windsor author. So she was always really cool about just information. I found her really useful and go out of her way helpful when it didn't benefit her or the library at all. So this was kind of cool, and I'm thinking there's no way this grant's going to come through, but you know, it was nice of her to ask. And then she messaged me, I forget when this would have even been, but probably the fall of what, last year, and said, yeah, it's going to happen, so we have to meet about how to make this work. I was shocked. So yeah, she just, it was entirely, you know, her general interest. So I don't know if someone came to her, but my thought is that she knew it was happening and was doing grant writing, and something just popped in her head and she dropped me a line. I think it's a lot like every music scene. It's got its cliques, and there's people who don't cross over because it's that venue and not that venue, or they don't want to go somewhere if it costs money. It hasn't really, to me, it hasn't changed in its scope in terms of who they are. They're all generous. They just like being in front of a crowd and playing. They're all really grateful for their successes. But they're really talented. Like, there's just something about these people who come from here and they have these great bands. And then it's like, oh, this drummer is moving to Fort McMurray. Oh, there goes five bands are done. Ugh, like these talents, and then they go somewhere else and they're a huge talent there. Like, the talent here is amazing. I think for some reason we cultivate a real serious artistic, you know, fortitude, and then, you know, that's, you notice it when they leave. I think it's like you go, wow, they're good. This is a strong scene. As they leave, you see what they were offering that you were taking for granted. But it's just full of really, I think, really good people, but really super talent. Because, like, they play everything. There's a bit of everything. And that's the thing. You'll see metal guys who will end up in some kind of a cover band to make money, but they're also in a kind of a softer side project thing. Like, they have multiple interests. They're not just, like, one-trick ponies. It seems like everybody's willing to cross genres. They're willing to. It's not that they do, even though a lot of them do. Jamie Greer, for crying out loud. The guy's wearing makeup and a Russian hat and screaming, or he's playing a tambourine and a gypsy folk blues thing, or he's playing folk rock It's like, there's a lot of that kind of attitude, and that's really cool. No, because that's the project was, I wanted to see that information on a screen. Like, I remember the first push was this weird silver poster that someone made at ArtSite. I love this. Like, I want to make something. I want to screen something. Because that was one of the first loves. Like, when I came in here, there was a drummer named Dan. What is his name? Sylvester. His last name is Sylvester. Huh? I see in your head, you're like, oh, I know all of the Sylvesters. If I looked at the book, I would know, but it's not Paul.
From the Low Towns?
No, he was in like Aaron Gignac's bands. This is going to make me nuts. But he had a shirt on, and I'm like, that is amazing. He's like, thanks. He's like, I made it. No, he didn't. He didn't make that. He's like, I can teach you. Like, we just met. You're going to teach me? And he's like, yeah, pick a time. And he came in and he taught me. And so from like 2004, very early on, I learned and was doing it for fun and did some Fog Fest or maybe some Fog related posters or t-shirts. I did a lot of t-shirts. So Brandon Sylvester taught me. So he's long gone. He doesn't live in the city anymore. He pops in maybe once every 3 years or something. But yeah, that's the first love, was I want to make a really nice poster of this information, but really the information and the stories behind it became the big push. And I just kind of resolved the fact that I wouldn't be able to make a poster with, it wouldn't work for some reason, or it was just, there was too much work left to do just in organizing the info that like, I will never even get to that. So like the fact that you're doing that is so, it's exciting. I love that idea. Because I printed some posters using the Kavanaugh shot that he came and did for free. Just, oh yeah, I'll come and shoot it. Yeah, come and photograph it. I think Earl at the art gallery called him. And he's like, yeah, I'll come down and do it. Brought all his lights, his gear, everything. Shot it for nothing. Like, okay. That's what the scene is like, right? That's how they are. So he comes, does that, and I printed that off. It's crazy expensive to print posters. I think if I learned one major lesson about this is you can have a great experience and learn a lot doing a project like this. If you want to make the money from a project like this, just run a print shop. Because that's where the money's at.